why you need this scan. I see patients every few weeks, women within my practice, that go from great bone structure to osteopenia and bam, to osteoporosis. In fact, I had a patient last week go from osteopenia to full-blown osteoporosis, necessitating IV infusions of medications within 16 months. Now, that's not normal, but she was only 62 years young, and that's devastating. And yes, you can see bone loss aesthetically in the face. You can see here how the facial bone deteriorates as well. You see, your spine and your hips are so important, of course, for the structure of your body. And when they quote unquote crumble, it is devastating and lifelong. In fact, the mortality rate after a hip fracture is about 40%. The good news here is that it doesn't have to be that way. The good news is you can do something about it. Now, the bad news is mainstream medicine is not going to do this scan for you. Your doctor likely isn't going to send you for this scan. You're sitting down here until you're at least 65 or 70. And the problem is, or the issue is, it's inexpensive. This isn't something that costs the system, your doctor, or you a lot of money, but healthcare companies are not paying for it till 65 or 70. And by that time, for many of you, you're having to go on medications to build your bone, and we like prevention way more than cure, as you know. Also, there's not a lot of radiation exposure here, because that's the next thing you're going to ask. In fact, 0.001 millisievert. A sievert is the unit that we measure radiation in. And if you think about an x-ray, just a regular plain film, it's about the same. But look at this, a dental x-ray is more, 0.005 millisievert. So if you're getting dental x-rays, maybe once every year or two, this scan is much less. A CT scan is all the way up to 10 millisieverts. So you can see there's just not a lot there. 5 to 20 millisieverts is the lowest dose that survivors of atomic bombs have been exposed to. So there's almost no downside to this scan. There's pretty much no radiation. In fact, if you're flying across the country in an airplane, you're exposed, like from if you go from the West Coast to the East Coast and you're in the plane, halfway across, so you start your journey, call it 2.5 hours into the flight, that's the same amount of radiation that you're being exposed to in that flight as if you were to get that scan. And it's why some people get them every 6 months to a year, but that's really overkill. You don't need them that often. You see, I think everybody should have a DEXA scan. And the great news is with this information, you can reverse key metrics of aging, not just bone, but key metrics that are associated with premature death. I did say reverse, and we love that here. You need to watch this video to the end because I'm going to give you 4 key tips as well based on your scan, but they're worthy of incorporating should you never even get this scan. But here's the thing. You're going to get 3 key metrics that you need to know about yourself from this scan. And I'll tell you, the cost is $150 or so. You can find them for under $100. You can find them for $250. And I'm going to go through a couple key metrics that you want to look for in your scan. And in my area, they even have a mobile one, a van that will come to you. It doesn't get any easier. As I go through the 3 metrics you're going to get, you'll see why this isn't just for females. So take your man with you. It's for all of us. So the first thing this scan is going to tell you, and how most of you know it, is you have to know your bone mineral density. Think osteoporosis here. How many patients are shocked when they get their scan back to see their bone mineral density is low and they actually need to go on medications? I mentioned the IV one. You'll know something also called Fosamax, which is a bisphosphonate. Again, it's devastating for people, but if you know beforehand, you can prevent it. And for women, of course, there's menopause and early hormone loss, and that can lead to osteopenia. And you go from osteopenic to osteoporotic, so more bone loss, I'll go through that in a minute, in a very short period of time. Look at this graph where women should be on the scale. You see the drop off around 50 years of age? Now compare that to the man. They don't get that drop off here. In the middle is where most people should be. On top of the line, in the middle, is means you have more bone density, and below this means you're below the average. Males have that slow decline of bone and of course hormones, whereas females, it's oh so important here because you have that drop. A lot of things happen in a very short period of time, as you know. Yet women are being advised to wait until 65 or 70 to get this scan. I mentioned hormones and hormone replacement. It's not for everyone, but you need to be aware of it because estrogen loss equals bone loss. I'll link a complete video at the end. I did. It's about 45 minutes, but you need to watch it because there's a lot of information on hormone replacement and bioidentical hormones. I'll put that at the end. Number two, I think you have to know how much visceral fat you have. More on this in a minute, but this is why you should also bring the male partner to the scan. It's not just for women. And this is something that's getting worse and worse, the fat around your organs and the implications of that. The third thing, I think you need to know how much muscle mass you have. Dexa is a much more accurate way than the traditional body mass index. We all know how that falters. And remember the calipers that people use to pinch areas of the skin and then determine what your body fat is? Well, this is 2024, people. We have scans with almost no radiation, as I mentioned, that will tell you what it is. You don't have to extrapolate or infer. You see, many people find out they have fat all around their organs despite looking great on the outside. They are oblivious to what's actually happening to their liver, to their kidneys, to their pancreas, and other organs. So why is this visceral fat so important? Well, the visceral fat is that fat that wraps around your abdominal organs deep inside your body. You can see it here in this picture. You can't always feel it or see it. In fact, you may have a pretty flat tummy and still have the visceral fat. It's not the fat that you pinch on the outside of the body. There is a correlation, but not always. That's sometimes called TOFI, or thin on the outside, fat on the inside, T-O-F-I. Only a scan can measure how much belly fat is hiding in you. But remember, your doctor isn't going to order this scan. And remember, it's in a third of us have this issue, and it's trending towards a half of us. Even though they only cost $150, that would burden the health insurance company if they all of a sudden said, yes, we recommend this for everyone over the age of 35, 40. Before we go a little deeper into visceral fat, let me discuss osteopenia versus osteoporosis. Osteopenia is a condition that refers to the bone density that is lower than normal, but not low enough to be classified as osteoporosis. That's the next stage if you don't catch it. It's often considered a precursor, therefore, to osteoporosis. People with osteopenia have bones that are weaker than average, but not yet to the extent where they're highly susceptible to fractures. Now, osteoporosis, on the other hand, this is the severe condition characterized by a significant bone loss, making the bones brittle and fragile. It increases the risk of fractures greatly, even from minor falls and injuries. And I told you the implications of a fall and a hip fracture. It's devastating. When you stop moving, you die. I mean, that's dramatic, but you get the point. Let's talk to visceral fat because you need to know how important this is, and let's go through the dangers of visceral fat. You see, too much body fat of any kind, of course, is bad for your health. But compared to the fat that lies just underneath your skin, the one that you pinch, we call it subcutaneous fat, the visceral fat, that fat around your organs, is more likely to raise your risk of serious medical issues. There are correlations here. Heart disease, Alzheimer's, type 2 diabetes, stroke, high cholesterol, and some of the conditions that are strongly associated are ones that are the most common in society, of course. Visceral fat is sometimes called active fat because it plays an active role in how your body functions. But here's the good news. You see, visceral fat is actually easier to lose than subcutaneous fat. So the fat around your organs goes first oftentimes. This is because it metabolizes quicker and your body can get rid of it and sweat it out. And you also pee it out. If you start regularly exercising and eating a healthy diet, you should start to see results on your scan in 2 to 3 months. You see, visceral fat makes more of certain proteins that inflame your body's tissues. So many of us are inflamed, and they also narrow the blood vessels. That can make your blood pressure go up and cause the other problems. You see, it's a huge cascade of events, and you've probably heard of metabolic syndrome. It's a spiral where each negative factor feeds unto itself like a snowball rolling down a hill, or that domino effect where one system trips and it affects all the other systems and they run out of control. So we know men and women are different, but what does race have to do with it? Check out this graph of how visceral fat differs in different races. You can see that black males fare the best at holding on to their bone, followed by white males, and then black females fare better than white females, but both have that drop off due to estrogen. So being female puts you at risk, and a white female particularly. And so this is an important part of your own personal risk stratification. Now the other metric is muscle mass. Why is this important? It's a huge predictor of longevity and health. How can this scan help you in this way? And why do you need to know your muscle mass? What does it have to do with your hormones and your longevity? Well, number one, muscle's important for metabolic health. You see, lean muscle mass is metabolically active tissue, meaning it burns calories even at rest. So I worked out yesterday, I played hockey, I went skiing, I'm burning calories sitting here, and you will too. Individuals with a higher lean muscle mass have a higher basal metabolic rate, which can help in maintaining a healthy weight and reducing the risk of obesity and, of course, the metabolic disorders that so many of us have. Think type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular disease. Heart disease is the number one killer of us. Number two, functional ability. Remember I said you don't move, you die? Well, strong muscles are essential for maintaining functional independence and mobility, especially as we age. You hear a lot about grip strength. Adequate lean muscle supports activities of daily living, like walking, climbing stairs, lifting objects, and maintaining balance. I did a whole video on Japan. You see, they walk everywhere, they're moving, they climb stairs, they don't take elevators. Preserving muscle mass delays the onset of age-related declines. The number three importance of your muscle mass is bone health itself. Resistance training, which promotes the development of lean muscle mass, stimulates bone growth and density. Bone needs to see resistance and hits for it to grow. It's particularly important in preventing osteoporosis and reducing the risk of fractures, of course. I have whole videos on three exercises that are most beneficial to building your bone. Number four, this is a huge one for me, and it's hormonal balance, because lean muscle mass is linked to improved hormonal balance, including increased sensitivity to insulin, which helps regulate your blood sugar levels, and it lowers the risk of insulin resistance and type 2 diabetes. Additionally, resistance training promotes the release of hormones. Here it is, I talk about it all the time, growth hormone and testosterone. Look at people with higher levels of testosterone growth hormone, particularly women postmenopausal, and they look younger. I see it in my practice all the time. So you see the importance of knowing your muscle mass. And the beautiful thing of this is when people get it and you show it to them, they're very motivated to increase it and to decrease their visceral fat. And they achieve it because they know it. You see it. You have something you can measure. If I just take calipers, you're like, oh yeah, Rajani took calipers to me. But if I show you your scan and the calculation, there's something objective that you can change, and it does change. It's amazing to watch. Now, before you get your scan, I want you to ask them if they're going to calculate this automatically for you, and it's something called ALMI, A-L-M-I. Some scans are going to automatically spit this number out, and others, if they don't, you can calculate it, but it's nice to have it. It stands for Appendicular Lean Mass Index, and it measures lean muscle mass in your arms and your legs. This offers a precise insight into your muscular health by dividing the lean tissue mass in the limbs by your height squared. You want to be at or above the 75th percentile on this. It's a great indicator. Now, you may be asking me, hey, Rajani, why not just get a normal x-ray? Well, standard x-ray diagnostics are only available to detect bone loss greater than 40%. There's too much bone gone by that point to see it on an x-ray. But the Dexa scan can measure it within 2 to 4%. You see, before the Dexa scan came around, the first sign of bone density loss was when an older adult broke a bone, came into the hospital, you took a plain x-ray, said, oh, they're osteoporotic. Again, way too late. But that's how it was diagnosed before we had scans like this. So how do you get rid of your visceral fat? I'll do more videos on visceral fat because you have to understand the implications of this. But let's say you don't want to get a scan, or maybe you're going to get a scan and it showed you have high visceral fat. These are important. The single best way to lose visceral fat is by maintaining a healthy lifestyle. You can lower your visceral fat level by focusing on diet, the same diet and exercise plans you would if you're going to lose weight. That will help reduce it. When you talk about exercise, you don't have to make this complex. You know, brisk walking for 30 minutes, that's what you're aiming for, 30 minutes a day. And this could also, and I recommend this, include cardio and strength training. Just don't overdo it on the cardio. A real popular workout amongst people trying to lose their visceral fat is high intensity interval training, or HIIT, H-I-I-T. These workouts cycle between bursts of intense effort and quick recovery. That's what I do, and I often do it on a stepper so I don't wear out my joints. Eat a healthy diet. A healthy diet includes lean proteins, whole grains, low-fat dairy, if you're into dairy, fruits and vegetables. Try to limit trans fats, refined sugars, sodium, and of course, processed food. Low-carb diets, such as the ketogenic diet, they can help reduce the visceral fat by training the body to burn fat as a fuel rather than relying on the high carbs that you get. Many people find success in that. What about intermittent fasting? Remember the American Heart Association came out and said people have a higher risk of heart attack if they're fasting. I went through that. I'll link that video at the end. That was hogwash. But intermittent fasting is a weight loss strategy that I like, and it involves going through periods of eating and not eating. And that's successful for so many people with visceral fat. Watch my videos on intermittent fasting. Of course, good sleep. I have many videos on this, but you'd be shocked at what just getting a good night's sleep can do for you. Not getting enough sleep increases your visceral fat and it increases your cortisol. Reduce your stress as well, because in your body, cortisol increases with stress. And when you measure this, you'd be shocked at what stress does to your cortisol. More cortisol activates your body's fight or flight response, so you're anxious, and it triggers the storage of visceral fat. Think yoga, meditation. Those are great ways to get rid of your stress. I love meditation. Limit your alcohol intake. Alcohol intake is highly associated with visceral fat. Now, hormone replacement, you've seen, is a staple of what you need to do. So you're going to want to watch this video all about bioidentical hormone replacement, this one on intermittent fasting, and one up here about hacks for your best sleep. Keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.